Hello, coffee drinkers. Good morning. We're talking about 251s. That is because, well, it's for a multitude of reasons. Number one, though, I have a new book out. It's called Jazz Vocabulary for Electric Bass. 251s. The link for the book is below. You can get physical copies worldwide via Amazon. You can get digital copies with a whole video companion at my e-store. Those things are both linked below in the description of this video. But 251s, and more importantly, how do we get better at playing 251s, at working on and being able to navigate through that real fundamental element of jazz harmony and the vocabulary associated with that. Now, anyone who follows me, listens to my stuff, has any of my books, knows that I'm not a huge fan of giving you a ton of theory and a ton of jargon and a ton of things to think about while you're playing that are theory related. In this book, I made a little bit of an exception because I thought it was a great way to get into your hands, into your fingers, into your playing immediately some really common and commonly used tensions on a five chord as we go through our 251, and that was to work on the altered scale a little bit. So there's a whole section in the book on the altered scale, on what an altered scale is. The complicated way of saying it is that it's a melodic minor scale, a seventh mode of the melodic minor scale. So basically, If you're in key of C, so you have a D minor 7, G 7 to C. Let's pick a slightly hipper voicing for that. So 2-5. Basically a 2-5-1. And if you're 5 chord, in this case our G 7, the altered scale is like playing A flat melodic minor from G to G. As Chelsea pointed out in a recent podcast we did, we talked through the book. Go check that out, actually. I think it's episode 21. It might even be the latest episode of the podcast. Go check that out. That is also linked below. Chelsea brought up a great point in that so many college teachers, high school teachers, so many teachers in general say, well, that's what it is. That's the altered scale. Play the seventh mode of the melodic minor. And you get this scale from G to G, in this case, from the root of your five chord to the root of your five chord with all these tensions in it. And if that's all the information you're given, it doesn't sound particularly good. And it without any context, without any, and without a concept to go with it, it's kind of dumb. So I don't just want to stop there. Yes, in the book I explain what the altered scale is and how you can find it in the context of a melodic minor scale. But the key thing I think about that section of the book, especially right here, that was what I was playing when we opened up this video, was exercise 19 from the book. Is staying kind of diatonic on the one, on the two chord and the one chord, so really diatonic inside, and then getting out into these kind of more common, commonly used tensions on the five chord that do come from the melodic minor scale, and then going back into the one chord. Making sure we hit that sixth chord, that A7, to get back to our D minor. So we have our 2-5-1-6. That's our progression, four chords. And there are four examples in here of ways to use that that altered sound, that melodic minor sound, the seventh mode of the melodic minor over the five chord, just to get this information into your fingers immediately, to give you some real time, real world kind of, some stuff you probably recognize from albums you've listened to. If you've listened to any kind of this material, you probably recognize some of those sounds. Like if I just play over this 2-5-1 and play kind of diatonic, recognize some of that language, that vocabulary, and that was just using a C major scale to navigate all four chords. Excuse me. What gets interesting to me and what gives it that real kind of authenticity, if you like, playing in this style, is when you're really in control of each element. And that's exactly what this section is. Exercises 19 through 22 really give that five a little bit of a spice. We kind of spruce it up a little bit. Now, if you analyze that, and if you actually look at the notes we're getting when we go and play the out bit, we're actually getting a flat 9, a sharp 9, the major 3rd, the flat 13, sharp 11. These are all kind of commonly used tensions on a 5 chord when we're going from 5 to 1, especially a major 5 to 1 like this. We just have a slightly different framework to be putting those in terms of the altered information and the melodic minor stuff, basically a melodic minor, a half step up from the root of your 5 chord. If any of this is going by too quickly, don't forget, it's a video you're watching on YouTube. Pause, rewind, go over it again, take it at your own pace. That's really important. Another thing that's really important as I was doing that is, if you do have this book, or if you're working on, it doesn't matter about this book, if you're working on any material and you have an idea like this, maybe it's slightly newer to you, maybe you haven't been playing that material that much yet, maybe it's a fresh transcription you've made. What I was doing just then, playing exactly the same line over and over again, can be really useful. Just getting that specific thing in your, not just in your playing, the technical, motor skills to play that on the instrument, but getting it in your ear and connecting those two things. I think that's really important. And I find that happens probably the best, the most efficiently, if I use repetition. So I could literally, maybe I'll slow it down a little bit, just play it without the loop pedal. Especially taking it at that slower tempo, I can pay attention to the time, the phrasing, the feel, the sound, the articulation, and exactly where I'm placing those notes, and get really, really comfortable with it. Now, in the book, I'm working on exercise 19 here. These are written out in 12 keys, in bass clef. They're also in tab. They're also in treble clef. If there's any treble clef instrumentalists out there that want to work on this material, it's in treble clef as well. So we kind of try to make the book for as many people as possible. It's in 12 keys. That is a massive, massive thing when I'm working on stuff like this. Just take it at that slower tempo. Wind it through all 12 keys. That was when I started thinking. It was going really well up to that. I was just listening. I was trusting my ear. I was trusting my fingers to go where they've gone so many times before, to a fourth up, to the next key in the cycle of fourths. And I suddenly, in the middle of it, I started thinking. This is where it gets disconnected, at least for me anyway. And I thought, okay, the first chord here is A flat. We got A flat minor 7 to D7 to G flat major. I have a couple of places, I have a bunch of places I can play this actually. But as I played it in the higher register, I just casually thought to myself, oh, I could have played it down here as well. And right in that moment of thinking, that was when the disconnect happened. So basically, I hope you see where I'm going. The importance of repetition, the importance of being able to play an idea like this, or any idea, any material you're working on, in all 12 keys, in all areas of the instrument. Really nice challenge that if you've played it with the D minor here, the next time you go through the cycle, make sure you do it in a different octave. It's the same shape. We play this very simple instrument, so it is the same shape, but even with the simplicity of the mechanics of the instrument, it can get jarred, and you can jump out of position and get all kind of out of phase a little bit. So it's really important to be just as in control here as you are here, and every other place place you can possibly play those notes. So I guess this is good homework, regardless of whether you're working on the 251 book, the brand new book, linked below if you want to check this book out. Digital at my website, physical at Amazon.com. It ships worldwide. Be with you in a couple of days if you want that physical book. This is good homework no matter what you're working on. And the concept of just adding that little flavor of the altered or melodic minor sound to your five chord when it comes to playing 251s can really add some authenticity to it. I should maybe have prefaced this entire thing by what I'm about to say, but regardless, it's very, very important. And it's something I also included in the book, pretty comprehensive. It's a list of 30 solos by a really, really huge range of musicians that were really important to me in the development of this vocabulary in my playing. And my point being is that regardless of whether you use that list or whatever style of music it is, whether it's 251 or whether you're listening to Periphery or something like that, the listening element, the real world experience of listening to it, learning it by ear, transcribing that information, assimilating that vocabulary into your instrument, that is so important. That's where you get the phrasing from. That's where you get the time from, the sound from. That's hopefully where you get inspired, where that music is leaping out of the recording at you and saying, learn me, learn me, learn me. You don't understand me right now, but learn me. That's the thing to me that's the most important part, is the immersion in the sound and the fact that it should be your curiosity being, should be the driving force behind your learning process. And if you're really curious about something, if the music really turns you on and you're drawn into it and you can't live without it, that is the stuff you should be transcribing. My list in the book is probably a great place to start in this style, but it's by no means the definitive list. And it's by no means the thing you have to go and transcribe. It's just a suggestion. But make sure your curiosity is the thing that's driving your learning process. That will give you the greatest chance, in my opinion, for success and for happiness when you play music, because you're just so happy to grab the instrument and to work on those things that are inspiring. So, till the next time, don't forget to check out the new book below, 251s, Jazz Vocabulary for Electric Bass. It's brand new. It's super cool. Chelsea did an unbelievable job on this book with the layout and the design of the cover and the copying and everything. There's a bunch of text in there. It's chock full of stuff. Go check it out. Also check out the podcast. That's linked below. We did talk about this and 251s in general quite a bit and their practical applications in the last episode of the podcast, podcast number 21, the Hello Coffee Drinkers podcast number 21. So coffee drinkers, thanks for hanging out. I will see you guys very soon.